Hi everyone, welcome to Startup Recon. I'm here with the CEO and founder of my education club, Kaloian. Would you tell me a bit more about your motivations for creating MEC?
Well, my first startup was again in education, Edtech. It was a virtual classroom, online tutoring platform with a virtual classroom, something very similar to Zoom, which we're using right now, but with a specific whiteboard. There's such problems, some Indians, and we developed this for 3 or 4 years. It was very hard to convince teachers to use it. And as you can see, the COVID came and everything changed overnight. All the teachers, like it or don't like it, they start using, such tools. But doing this startup for 3, 4 years, went to a lot of EdTech conferences, spoke to a lot of people from EdTech, and I saw that actually the biggest challenge is not the technical tool, but how we learn. And I think that the most effective way to learn nowadays is still the old-fashioned way, which is peer-to-peer learning. People learn best from other people, from their experience. Yes, you can go to YouTube, Coursera, all these platforms, you can get some knowledge and you have the basic. But then when you have the specific problem, it comes to the specific question, you usually call a friend. And that's why I decided to create such platform where people go and can find other people with whom they can exchange ideas, experience, and to focus on their skills and knowledge, which will be the one of differentiator from platforms like LinkedIn, where people say we want to create network, but the focus there is on your job position and where you work. If you work in some famous nice company, then you get like a lot of request. But if you're if nobody company, then you don't get, which for me is wrong because you still have the same knowledge. It's the same with the teachers. If you're a teacher in Cambridge, usually the society thinks that you're a very good teacher, which in most cases like this. But you can be a very knowledgeable person, and for whatever reasons, you don't teach in Cambridge, but this doesn't mean that you don't have the knowledge. So I wanted to create such a platform, and that's how come the idea for my education come club created.
And in your short form interview, you mentioned how you want to match people based on their skills rather than just their job experiences. And you mentioned an integration with AI in the future. Would you like to elaborate a bit more on that?
Yes, the because behind peer-to-peer learning stands that the two persons, they have to like each other, they have to click. In the formal education, maybe you don't like your professor, but he is a good professor. You don't like him as a person, but he's a very knowledgeable person. You still go to the lecture. To do peer-to-peer learning, which it's not formal learning, when two people sit together in a coffee or just somewhere, walk in the park, and they still learn from each other. You have to like the person, and that's why it's very important to find the right person with whom you can learn from. A lot of people know React, a lot of people know Excel, a lot of people know English, French, etc. But with whom to connect is, the biggest issue. And here, on one side, we have filters, so you can use the filters and choose the person with whom you think you're gonna fit together. But the other one is to use data which is accumulated in the platform and the platform itself to suggest you the best person which with whom you're gonna click together. They are from like basic stuff like interest, skills, ratings, feedback. But also we're going to use psychological profiles and some other information. All this will going to be accumulated, going to be processed, and the platform will suggest that the best fit for you will be Alexander. And that's the idea how the AI to work. So the user is going to have choice between doing this with the filters by himself or to accept the suggestion of the platform for person with whom to connect to exchange the skills.
For MEC, what is your business model? How are you guys looking to make money off your users?
So far, we tried to develop the B2C aspect of the business. So if you right now go on myeducationclub.com, you're going to see the B2C platform. This is something like a social network, you can say. So the business model is based on once you have enough database of users, then you can use the information, the data you have, and sell it. It sounds, you know, not ugly, but that's, you know, pretty much all the platforms work like this, even Facebook. But in order to work like this, you gotta get enough critical mass, which is not easy to achieve. Of course, another option is to have a premium account. For example, if you want to have this psychological test, you gotta have a premium account. But this is the two ways to monetize the B2C platform. Because it's very hard to do it, especially from a small market like Bulgaria, to do a B2C platform, the last 3-4 months we're thinking about pivoting to the B2B model. And we believe that in any big company organization, there's enough knowledge, but it is not shared. You know that the company has a huge problem with the skills gap problem. They try different stuff, trainings. A lot of money is spent on training inside the companies with different LMSs, other tools. And still, most companies are not happy with the results they get from everything they use. And we believe that peer-to-peer learning maybe is a better solution. And that's why what we're doing with the B2C focus, now we're going to do similar stuff because we already have the experience and the knowledge, but it's going to be inside of the company, which means that we're not going to have the acquisition part of the users because we want to have the acquisition, but we have to convince Vodafone, for example, to use the platform. Once this is done, then the users will be in the platform, and then the second part, which is the engagement, and this is the crucial part because the tool by itself, you know, it's not so important. You know, you can have a lot of tools, Slack, and they use, you know, different purposes, but the key is the engagement, how to make people to use the platform. And we believe we have some experience and knowledge so far from what we have done on the B2C segment, and that's what we're going to do. So with the B2B focus, it's going to be normal, most probably SaaS service, which we're going to, you know, offer to the companies as a business model.
So at the moment, your clients are more individuals, but you're looking to try to engage corporate clients?
Yes, right now we are changing a little bit the platform, so it's adopted for the companies. This should be done by the end of the year, by Christmas, and then after Christmas we gonna start talking. I'm talking now to the company, but the software will be ready, so after Christmas we will start talking to the companies, and hopefully we'll do some pilots in Bulgaria, and if it works, of course, you'll be looking, you know, to go also abroad.
And when creating a peer-to-peer platform, what challenges did you face?
I think normal challenges for all startups. First one is for the team, which is very important because I'm not a technical person. I had problems, especially the second startup, to find a technical co-founder with whom we clicked together. It's not so much about the technical, you know, skills. So, of course, forming a very strong team was one of the challenges. And now, finally, maybe I found the right technical co-founder about 2 months ago. And the other big challenge for us is with trying to do a B2C platform at the beginning from a small market like Bulgaria, where we have, you know, just 7 million users, small market, and we have 2,500 users out of 7 million. But when I quote these numbers to investors, they think that's some type of joke. But I say, like, you know, I gather them on the street in front of my house. 2,500 people. But if you take this in terms of, let's say, population for the US, which is, you know, 50 times bigger than Bulgaria, this means that within 18 months, we should have had like over 100,000 users in the US. which is now sounds like a reasonable number based on these numbers.
Mm.
So being in a small market is very hard to make something which is working in the B2C segment. And the other one is also the financing. You know, okay, you are in UK, which is half between Europe and the US, let's say it. But still the financing is not as much as in the US. And the further you go east, you know, in Germany is less, then in Eastern Europe is even less. Because here in Bulgaria, if you raise 50,000 euros, as we did from an angel investor, this is considered like a big amount. But 50,000 euros is nothing when I have to compare and compete with, you know, startups and people who have raised, like, you know, pre-seed round of 500K in the US. Yes, the cost is more here in Bulgaria, but a lot of startups in the UK and the US, they raised according to their standards, and then they outsource the R&D in Bulgaria or Eastern Europe. Mm. And then, you know, the cost is pretty much the same. So if we want to do this, I know that we have to relocate and move to Western Europe or the US as soon as possible to a bigger market. Because it's going to be very hard to do it, you know, from a small country like Bulgaria, nowadays in 2020.
Yeah. And are you looking to expand the customer base to Western and English-speaking people?
Yes. Even now, the website, if you go to the website, it has an English version. Although it was, it's targeted for Bulgaria, we have the English version because of the expats who are in Bulgaria. But it doesn't matter if you're in the UK, since it has an English, you know, version, you can use it. But we are not ready yet because we want to validate the model here in Bulgaria, which is much cheaper. And we know the market, we have better, you know, connections with companies, even users. After that, we are planning to go to, you know, to Western Europe, to the US. Actually, we have, we started also in Russia, which is not Western Europe. But it's still a big market. That's because we have good relationship with the previous project. We did 6 months accelerate program, a partnership with MTS, which is the biggest Russian telecom, with their corporate accelerator. And I think Russia is very interesting market because it's big and it's kind of, how to say, overlooked for political reasons. It's not easy, but so we are planning to go abroad. I don't know if Russia is the right way, but obviously we have to move out from Bulgaria as soon as possible if we want to have significant, you know, success.
And on the topic of expanding your customer base, you said that your customers are adults only. Are you looking to also expand in a non-adult and kind of using like kind of classroom setting as well, maybe teaching as a class rather than person to person as well?
It can be done, but I think it has to be completely different platform because the set of people is different.
Mm.
Somebody who is 25 years old, 30 years old, you know, his interest, which is normal, are different than somebody who is 14 years old.
Yeah.
The students in school, they still can learn, you know, best from, you know, sharing their experience. But if you do it for high school students, then you should focus just on high school students and all the users there to be, you know, say, high school students. Otherwise, a 15 years old will have not much in common with somebody who is 40 years old like me.
With the users, do you have any sorts of vetting process of how do you know that they actually have the skills that they claim to have?
We get a lot of this question, which is normal, because usually when you say learning, people say, how do you know that Alexandra is very good in English? And peer-to-peer learning is different, at least according to us. And we leave this up to the users. Because at the end, who says that John is the best in Excel? Maybe he has all the certificates, etc. But maybe his style of teaching or even as a person is not the best one for me. And that's why me as a person, I'm going to choose which person I feel best. It's not so much about the quality, but with whom person I spent, you know, good time, I learned from him. And this counts with the, that's why we have the rating and the feedback. Like, you know, Airbnb, etc. So if Alexandra is okay for me, I'm happy with, you know, with what he helps me with, then I'm going to give her a good rating. It doesn't mean that she's the best one in Excel or in English, but for me, it works. So I'm happy with that. So we just leave it to the people.
For your future aspirations, what are you more generally looking to do in the future?
Well, the next steps will be to finish the software development of the platform by the end of the year, so it's ready for the companies, as a client, for the B2B segment. Then we will start validating and having hopefully several pilots with local companies here in Bulgaria, big companies, because in order to have peer-to-peer learning, you gotta have a big enough company which has at least 200 employees.
So more generally, what is your kind of near future timeline?
Well, by the end of the year, the plan is to finish with the software development of the platform, so it's ready to use it in corporate environment for companies. After that, we're planning to have several pilots with companies in Bulgaria, local companies, but actually international companies, because in order to have peer-to-peer learning in a company, it should have a lot of employees, at least, let's say, 200 people. If it's a small company with 10, 15 employees, they know each other, so there's no point of, you know, such a platform. So a company which has a lot of employees, several offices, is much more appropriate for that. And once this is done, hoping to go abroad, one of the ways which is more probable is to go to accelerator program. And through that, you know, to have 3-4 months in that foreign country to get to know the environment, the investors. The other options is to get the financing directly from a VC fund from abroad and to move there, but this will be the harder way, just because, you know, we got the financing in Bulgaria, that's because people know me. It's normal at such, you know, stage, pre-seed, seed, people invest in companies, they know the founders and they trust the founders. Nowadays, at that point, nobody knows us in UK or Germany or the other countries. And that's why more probable is to go to accelerator program. But if somehow we convince this investor that, you know, we have a great project and they invest in us, then we still can move to the UK, for example, without going for the accelerator program.
Well, best of luck with that. And thank you very much, Kaloian, for taking the time to have an interview with us. If you would like to find out more about MEC, the links will be down in the description. And thank you very much for watching. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.